The month of September brought some elevated equity volatility as the NASDAQ went from all-time highs and then had a 15% correction. Scott Bauer, the losses we've seen, is it about economic fears or is there something we're missing?
It's economic fears and it's history, Jim, quite frankly. September, the most volatile and the worst performing month of the year. So there was some expectation going into September. And then we got the elevated levels in the tech space, in the NASDAQ, climbing to all-time highs and valuations that, many compared to 2000 to the tech bubble, which, I don't know, fair comparison or not, but nonetheless, pretty lofty levels. So we were kind of ripe. We were kind of set up for volatility and for a little bit of a sell-off, which we saw. And quite frankly, I think that is very healthy for the market. But, moving forward here, the economy is still very much in focus going through the rest of this year.
So, Tim McCourt, two things. One, we saw the weakness in the NASDAQ, and we did see a bit of a rotation into the Russell, into the less work from home names, maybe not enough to celebrate it yet. But the one thing that I noticed was going into the sell-off, volatility, implied volatility in options was actually quite high. When you see that going into it, does it make you think that it'll be more of a run-of-the-mill correction and less eventful than if volatility was really compressed coming in?
The answer to this is definitely not. Going into a sell-off with somewhat elevated implied volatility doesn't give you much information about how deep or how long it will last. And I think going beyond just this past September, there are conflicting observations. Think back to March when the NASDAQ volatility, as measured by the vol Q, peaked out at 80. And then we sold off, and then we touched new highs several months later. Then go back to around 2000 or 2007 with higher levels of implied volatility in the market, the greater the chance for a deep bear market. But recall that implied volatility rose into those market peaks, and those bear markets all began off of implied volatility levels that were significantly off previous lows. And those volatility regimes didn't prevent those bear markets from going down and staying down for a while. So I don't think anyone should draw that conclusion.
Scott, keeping with the FANG names theme here, we're looking at not too distant future of tech week from earnings week. Do those names have to show good numbers to justify the run-up we've seen? Plus, the second part to that question, too, if we see the coming back online economic rotation out of NASDAQ, can the market handle that elegantly and still move higher while that's going on?
So number one, yes, they're going to have to give good guidance. Many of these firms did not give guidance last quarter. They will have to give good guidance. And to me, that will be more important than the actual numbers that they report. So that's number one. And don't count tech out. Even though many got dinged after the last report, don't count them out yet. Number two, if we start to see some sort of rotation out of there, can the market deal with that? Can the market handle with that? Yes, absolutely. Maybe we'll see some added volatility.
Tim McCourt, when you looked at the six-month run-up in tech stocks, do you think it was a run to the protection of a strong balance sheet just by excess money around the globe? Or do you think it was actually a fundamentally work-from-home transition to a new age of technology trade? And I know the answer to that is both, but break it up into percentages if you could.
Yeah, and it's not even just the FANG stocks. I think it's all things NASDAQ related. Look at things like the micro e-mini NASDAQ futures, and those are trading record levels here in 2020. But to your point, it's both. I think the work from home environment and the balance sheet, plus the Fed's quantitative easing. QE created $3 trillion between March and May, and that money had to go somewhere. First, it sent bond yields lower. Record lows. It in turn then made investors look for safer investments and look at these story stocks of the NASDAQ like FANGs and throw Microsoft in there. And these have big, stable businesses. Some of them like Microsoft even paid dividends that rival bond yields. These companies were beneficiaries for sure of the work from home environment, but they've also been outperforming since 2014. So I think the pandemic definitely accelerated the economy's move in their direction.
Scott Bauer, we have an election. We have COVID numbers are ever changing. We have an economy that's coming back online. What's the biggest driver, biggest thing to worry about over the next month and a half?
Well, from a realistic perspective, it shouldn't be the election. Regardless of the outcome, the market is going to be the market. Over time, it really shows there's not a big difference between whether Democrat or Republican president in office. To me, it is really COVID and how we get back to being online? Are we going to have this second wave that many people are talking about, which could really just put a halt to this economic recovery that we've seen so far? So over the next 3 months or so, to me, it is squarely on COVID. Beyond that, Jim, people are going to worry about the election, what happens going into 2021. But honestly, to me, it factors on what happens with a vaccine, what happens with the reopening. Because again, whoever's in office, the market's going to be what the market's going to be.
Regardless of the outcome of the November election or the potential arrival of a COVID vaccine, my expectation is for the volatility to continue on and on for the next couple months.